We're on.
So today I will be talking about the effects of medicines and like when they're used in birds and how it can affect the birds and everything. So this was actually inspired by the internship I had this past summer at a zoo. And whenever I wasn't doing like shadowing the vet, watching procedures and stuff, I was actually helping with the bird rehabilitation system that they have there. All right, so first, just some general facts about birds. Their metabolism is definitely high, and so that can definitely play a role into when you start to think about the medicine. And some different factors would be the frequency of the medicine drug administration. And for birds with a higher metabolism, you might have to give them more, but you also have to know how the drug would interact with the body. So you might not be able to give them as much as you would like to. So toxicity of it would be one for that.
So some of the drugs you're saying have a shorter half-life in birds than, let's say, mammals, because the jacked up metabolic rate,
yes.
Okay?
Yes. And then also, there are differences among the different species of birds that can affect how medicine will interact, as I'll give an example in later slides. And also how the dosage is determined can determine kind of what medicine, how much medicine to give the bird. Their temperature generally runs around 41 degrees Celsius, so that's just a little over 100 Fahrenheit. With that and their metabolism, it requires a lot more energy to actually maintain that. Birds can easily be stressed, and so that can actually increase their temperature, and usually anything over 46 degrees Celsius is actually going to be for sure fatal to the bird, so it's best to kind of keep it down. Birds that are more smarter, more intellectual, or birds that can imprint more easily can be more stressed in certain situations. So that's why working with the Wild Bird Rehabilitation Center, we had to make sure to keep minimal contact with the birds so that they wouldn't imprint on us, and it would keep them safe after we release them back into the wild. So the last kind of little thing down here is that the talons, whether the bird is large or small, is definitely something you want to watch out for, but especially if the bird is large, it can actually do some real damage. And so just handling with care for both the bird's sake and the handler's sake to keep a low stress environment for the bird. So some common medicines used in birds, these go. These are just some ones that I had seen most often during my internship. There's likely a few more, but the main two I had seen would be meloxicam and Baitrol. This one I didn't see used as much, but it was definitely one of the ones that I saw a couple times in my during my internship. So this over here is actually a great horned owl that we got in. And he was having troubles in his left eye. We would use non-steroidal BNP ointment, and it seemed to improve whenever we used that, but whenever we tried to take him off of that, it would always get worse. So this is actually an enucleation surgery, which is the removal of that eye. And the only way it is ethical to still release birds with one eye is if it's, say, like an owl, they can still kind of turn their head, they won't be like blindsided. So some smaller birds with their eyes on their side, it would actually not be as ethical to release if you had.
So you'd have to keep it its lifespan. The bird
that wouldn't be able to be released.
Right.
We would usually have to euthanize it.
Oh really?
We can't keep up with wild birds coming in and in and out.
Okay.
We wouldn't be able to kind of keep up with that. So.
Gotcha.
And it wouldn't be ethical to release them
right.
while still having issues with their eyes. So that was the best option as that as it was. Meloxicam, if you notice, this is also non-steroidal. It's an anti-inflammatory, and it is also a painkiller. And one thing with this one especially is that it can dehydrate. Now, with raptors, you don't have to worry about that as much because they get a lot of their water from the meat that they eat. They don't actually go and physically drink water often really at all. But it's definitely something to watch out for in smaller birds, so like songbirds or anything like that. There was actually kind of a case where one of them, we had a barn swallow that came in. He was rather dehydrated, but he also had had a leg amputation, so he was on Moxcam and had to make sure to keep up with that. So Vatrol is just another one, metronidazole. It's this one, so sorry for all the words, by the way. But
what's the EF stand for there for your?
Just examples. So Vatrol, we would use in birds that would come in that would have like a cat attack that, or would have been like found near a cat, because with all the microbes in the mouth of the cat, it would be just an extra precaution to make sure that nothing would happen, no infection would happen. And then we could just get that out of the way. So kind of the same with between these two, kind of just using them in a situation to help prevent any infection from happening. So not many studies have actually been done on different kinds of drugs being used in birds as compared to mammals. And so sometimes it's kind of hard to say, and it's trial and error and trying to figure out what would need to be used in a bird. And also steroids in birds, based on an article I saw, they should be used with extreme caution or a lot of research to try and figure out just what was, just how it will react with the bird, because it is an immunosuppressant, and in birds, just like their metabolism can kind of decrease the half-life, the immunosuppressant kind of steroids can have more of an effect in birds, which can make it easier for them to get an infection. So, and it can also cause hyperglycemia.
Okay.
All right, so kind of going off of the steroid part of it not being as good for birds, here's some other ones that are harmful to birds. So expired tetracycline, so any kind of antibiotic that has been expired would be best not to use in birds, because the active part of the ingredient could, it won't be as active, and some of it could like change around in such a way that it wouldn't react with the bird and the body in the same way that you would want it to. So it is definitely toxic and most likely will be fatal. So Adequan, this is for sure going to be fatal in most birds, and pretty much all of them actually. But it's actually used in mammals. So when thinking about medicines, not all medicines can be used interchangeably between mammals and avian species. So it's definitely something to look out for. And this drug, Adequan, actually falls under the PSGAG, polysulfated glycosaminoglycans. So based on the article that I read, there is a potential formula change over time that could have been the base of a cause between a higher reaction rate in recent trials with it. So because before the formula change, there weren't as many cases seen with birds having fatal reactions to these kinds of drugs. So there's, again, not much evidence, not much research done on medicine in birds that on its own can be fatal. There were some case studies that I looked at where some birds already had some predispositions while they were kind of being treated with the PSGAG. So it's not clear as to whether that was the exact cause for the hemorrhaging that it would cause in the bird. And I guess another example to kind of back this up and make it even more confusing, I guess, is that in cranes, there are actually no bad reactions seen with using these PSGAG drugs. So it really does depend between the species. And then down, coming back to steroids, corticosteroids especially would not be advisable to use in birds. Again, a lot of, because of the immunosuppressant
that you had on the other slide, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Kind of just some things that I read is that unless there's any serious infection or anything, it would be advisable to not use steroids. How I have here, down here, I kind of just gave my best guess, so I don't know if this part right here would be milligrams per gram of the dry medicine or milligrams per milligram. So, but it's the same kind of concept that it's just the mass times the dose times the concentration about, which is the same up here. So, you take mass of the kilograms in kilograms of the animal.
And which then, would be pretty small for some of those birds. I mean, crazy.
Yes, and so that's actually when the concentration of the medicine that we gave actually came into play, because if you had a higher concentration, you wouldn't get as much that you were using in the bird, so you'd have to move to a lower concentration to actually get a sufficient amount that would...
To measure out, yeah.
Yeah, to get something that could be measured into a milliliter syringe, mm-hmm. for the small birds at least.
Right.
So, yeah.
Okay, are you ready for questions?
Yeah.
Okay, now where was this at? Where?
The Abilene Zoo down in Texas.
Oh, in Texas, Abilene, Texas. Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh, really? Okay, I missed that part. I'll let you point at people.
Yes, so I did an internship at a wildlife rehab center, and before we released our birds, we vaccinated them for common diseases. Do you guys do that too?
Not that I'm aware. They had been just within the past couple years, there's been kind of a transfer of the management, so it's kind of been changing, but not that I am aware.
That's a good question, because all the wild birds out there aren't vaccinated at all, but they still are protected because of their exposure to things. But that's a good question.
And with going from like bird feeders to bird bats and stuff,
right?
If you're gonna release them, like why not help them out?
I understand the logic. This thing about these birds, like you said, there's not a lot of research because you don't research these birds. You don't have 50 of these birds and you do something. You can have 50 chickens and you can have 50 turkeys, but you don't have 50 raptors to do an experiment on. So it's kind of case by case. That's where you need to talk to people. If you're working with birds, you can call other centers. Like I'm from Minnesota, and I know at the University of Minnesota, they had a raptor rehabilitation center, and that was always kind of neat, just raptors.
I guess to kind of just add on to, it's not vaccinating them. They are actually confirmed. It's confirmed that they're in a healthy state to actually survive out in the wild, whether or not
before they release them. Yeah. Okay. Well,